Can't hear the vacuum, can you?
No.
Okay, good.
I've got AC as well, so it's great. Great. I'm gonna go on mute. Okay, we're on. Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining today. For anyone that's new, that hasn't been with us before, Mona is the leading 3D world building platform for high quality social digital experiences. As Mona is synonymous with creative expression, exploration, and entertainment. We've launched Mona Shorts Fest, the first Metaverse short film festival dedicated to film shot solely in Mona. Mona Shorts Fest aims to champion emerging and established creators, discover award-winning 3D talent, and curate innovative experiences and push the boundaries of 3D world building and avatar narratives. So as part of this, we have the workshop series that brings in industry leaders and experts to your fingertips to help you level up your film and storytelling knowledge. And today we welcome Sam. Sam is the lead product designer at Doodles, the 10K PFP project by Bone Toast. Sam has worked at Dapper Labs on NBA Top Shot, been in Web3 since 2017, has been designing for almost a decade, although it does not look like it. And in a previous life, studied at Parsons, loves cozy gaming. Let's unpack that a bit later. Collecting bold, colorful artwork and cuddling cats. Welcome, Sam.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Thanks for your time. We imagine you're quite busy at Doodle, so really appreciate that. So I'm gonna hand over to Sam, and Sam's gonna take us through how to design an epic movie poster to help anyone that's entering Mona Shorts monetize their film eventually. So I'm going to leave you in Sam's capable hands, and we're going to have moments during this where we're going to take questions. So feel free to drop questions in the YouTube or on Twitter or any of our socials, and the team will sweep it up and we'll have moments where we pause. So over to you, Sam.
Yeah, feel free to interrupt me if there's any question that's relevant to a particular slide. Happy to take a pause. So let's get started. How does to design a poster for a short film? So, I mean, there's lots of reasons why a poster is important. It's like a form of advertising, basically. You want to get it out there so people can see and know about it. It's going to capture people's attention, build excitement, impart specific information that should be really quick and digestible, including like the tone. It could be a particular scene, the plot, but giving them a glimpse into what they should expect and get them excited about it. Really, it's just about driving attention, like any sort of advertisement would be. So, I mean, if you break it down for each type of poster, like movie poster you see, there's like some key elements. There's some sort of like very large visual, eye-catching. Like I was saying, it's usually a scene within the movie. Like you can kind of see in the Little Miss Sunshine in that moment where they're running after the van. Or it's emphasizing the particular actors within the movie. And then they're showing them in a certain way that's supposed to evoke some type of emotion, like Barbie being very Barbie, when there's, as opposed to like more intense scenes like you might see with Titanic or the Moonlight one. Title, generally huge. So you know exactly what movie you're going to see. And a lot of the time you also additionally see a tagline. This is a smaller a lot of the time. You can see on the Barbie one, it says, "She's everything. He's just Ken." So you can kind of tell there's like humor within that as opposed to like Moonlight, which is, this is the story of a lifetime, which is much more intense. So again, conveying that tone. And then you always see like this huge chunk of text usually where they have all of the credits. So you can see that more under Moonlight or Titanic. It's just to like highlight people, emphasize them and make sure they're obviously getting the credit. But there are posters that pare it down, such as Barbie, or highlight, again, the specific actors and really bring them to the forefront, which they did within Little Miss Sunshine, because they really wanted to emphasize certain people in there. The first step, really, after you kind of know what elements you're looking for, is to gather as much inspiration as possible. I do this by looking at the specific thing that I want to make to start. So I would look at tons of movie posters. So you want to really analyze what's existing from a huge range. So you can kind of see in that image, they're all very blue. They have a certain tone to them, but they're all really, really different from each other. It's a little small, but hopefully you can see that. We can make it a bit bigger. There we go. There's lots of ways of expressing something, even just with that single image and that single tone. And you can also tell within this one that you want to tell your story. It's very hard to tell a story with one image because you're capturing just one moment in it, as opposed to this, like, even if it's a short film, it's still a good length of time where you're really trying to show the characters and have them evolve. Capture a single image is really hard. So you can see they're usually quite dynamic. Even with like Jaws one, which I think is like a fantastic classic movie poster. It's really intense, but it's like really clear what's going on here, right? So there's a lot of places that I like to look for inspiration. Honestly, these are probably my top three. Dribbble is fantastic. It has a lot of illustration, a lot of web design. So it's got like the full gamut of different types of design you can look at. Behance is similar. You have to have an Adobe account for that one and for Dribbble as well, but you can just sign up with like your Google or whatever. And Pinterest, which you'd think, really, Pinterest? But shockingly, Pinterest has probably some of the best inspiration because it's just such a large breadth of work in there. So I do actually get a ton of inspiration from that site. And like I was saying, you start with movie posters when you're looking for inspiration. But my hot tip is start looking at other things. So I primarily do product design, but I actually go and look at a lot of print design as my inspiration. So I wouldn't say constrain yourself to movie posters, but look toward other types of posters. Concert posters would be a really, really good one for this as well, because they're trying to do something similar where it's not exactly the same media, but they're trying to like get that interest from people. The information displayed might be slightly different, but I think that you will find like a lot of good inspiration from that. And just other general graphic designs, typographic layouts, because this is going to be fairly important, the typography on this, you want to make sure that you're looking at things with type and fonts. You never know when the inspiration will hit, actually. The one thing I do want to call out, though, is that you want to make sure that you're making something new. This is why I also gather a ton of inspiration. And I think this is how a majority of creatives work. You tend to like copy things until you get really good at something. So it's not really bad to do that. It's when you copy it one for one that's the issue. The way that I work is I deconstruct everything and I pick the elements that I like the best and then reconstruct it for my particular problem that I'm solving.
Hey, so, Sam, we've got a question in.
Yeah.
Do you mind pausing there? Sorry. Sure. How important is the font choice in a movie poster? So maybe a couple of slides back in terms of typography. Typography can conjure a lot of elements of the film and take the tone of the film. So how important to you in your mind is typography against image assets, against, you know, actors and so on?
I mean, typography is it's a very strong visual element. And since this is like going to be a huge emphasis on the poster itself, like it's the title of the movie, you've got to try to nail that as close as possible. Like you can see a huge difference from Moonlight, which is this very like, even though it's all caps, they made it very thin and very soft. And Titanic is this like this really bold, intense font. And then Barbie, like they have this swirly, like shiny B. Like it's saying very different things on each one. If you went and slapped papyrus on any of these, it wouldn't have the same feel. Slight, like, you know, a little bit of a slight to Avatar, but
yeah. Where are your top platforms to like, you know, inspire you for fonts? Like, where do you go? What font libraries do you go to?
Yeah, I think I might actually.
Oh, okay. Sorry, taking you forward.
No worries. Yeah, I have that on here a little bit. So for choosing different elements, a key place for imagery, because again, you want to really make sure you're not directly copying anyone. So if you go to Google, make sure you have like the Creative Commons license, like make sure you're not stealing from somebody. I really like to go to Unsplash. They're super high quality images. They have a pretty large library, so you can generally find something. I imagine for this particular poster, you're going to want to use imagery that's coming from your film directly, though. But that doesn't mean you don't want to like layer things or add other elements in. So Unsplash is like a go-to for me. For fonts, actually, Google Fonts isn't that bad. I use it specifically because like product design, web design, like I need to. Be really careful if you go to places like DaFont, dafont.com, because a lot of them are very tricky to work with. There's some really messy ones. You have to be careful in terms of like making sure the spacing between the letters and the lines feels balanced. And a lot of those fonts tend to be kind of crooked and like uneven. So there's Google Fonts. There's a lot of different type foundries that you can look at that will let you use demo fonts for like personal work. But yeah, I'd just be cautious in terms of like using anything for commercial purposes. Because it's the same with photography or like taking someone else's artwork. Like it's the same thing. It is art in its own, like it's design in its own way. So Google Fonts is just like a really safe bet. You want to use some like generally clean typography that isn't like, it's not going to have like crazy fonts in there, but it will give you like a decent breadth and different feels for you.
Feel free to take us back where you were before. Sorry, we jumped forward.
No worries. That's totally fine. Yeah. So just again, just going back and kind of emphasizing that a little bit more, when you're taking all of these collective elements and piecing them back together, that's when you start creating your own style. So you might already have a style and personality if you've been doing design or art for a while, but if you start playing around with new elements, you don't pressure yourself into like, oh, this looks so similar to something else. As long as you're kind of adding a little bit something different in there, it's okay, because copying is how you get better at something. But yeah, just don't do one-to-one. And don't like beat yourself up if it doesn't look perfect the first time around either. Something you really want to do is make lots of versions, because each version you'll learn something new. So I also would say, and I don't think I actually have this in here, maybe at the end, but as you're taking this inspiration and recreating it to make your own thing, make lots of different versions. Something that we did in school, this is a classic exercise that they give you in any sort of art school. They give you something really basic. I had a frog, and they tell you to draw it 100 times in different ways. So at first you're like, oh, that's sure, fine. I can draw a frog, like 100 different versions of a frog, fine. You run out of ideas pretty quickly. Like it's probably, you're probably hit 20 and you're like, this is getting really difficult. I have to do another 80 of these. And you have like, you just get a piece of paper, like big piece of paper, little squares, and draw different versions of a frog. You start zooming into them. You start looking at different types of frogs. Like you realize very quickly that it is very hard to actually have like a huge breadth of iteration, but it does teach you to exhaust all of the really obvious ideas first and start looking at things a little differently. So whenever you approach anything design related, even if it is remixing to create something new, I would just recommend doing that, because you will find something special if you keep pushing yourself. And you don't have to do this in like an hour for one piece. Start off with just really quick sketches or collages and try to pop them out in a really like short time frame. So just like time yourself basically and be like, I'll do 2 minutes for each version. I'm going to do 10 versions and see what I get. Some more recommendations for like tools you can use. I use Figma, which I don't know if that's particularly print friendly, but there's a ton of tools you can use. Adobe Illustrator is obviously like a more advanced one. I'm not even familiar with all of the new things they have in there. It's pretty insane, but you can even use something super simple like Canva, and they have really good tools within Canva for helping you even just cut out like objects within images and stuff like that. It's pretty advanced for like it's more of like a deck designer, but it can work for like visual poster things. I've designed in like Paint before. Like you can do whatever you need to do within whatever tool you have. But just whatever is accessible to you, go for it. And then some like quick tips, I would say, for creating layouts is you want to make sure you have good contrast. So you don't want everything to feel like it is the same size, for example. It's kind of the idea of contrast and hierarchy. You want to give it like room to breathe, as you can kind of see in the examples on the right. You have very large typography. You have this pretty bold image, but there's a lot of space around it, so it balances it out a little bit. And make sure things are aligned. As you can kind of see in some of the images in the middle, things are very much on a grid. It's best just to make a grid and stick with a grid if you're new to anything design related. There are pre-made grids and things like that that you can just overlay, place things on. Start off with like really simple, again, like kind of like the copying, and see what actually works before you start breaking things. Like work with the fundamentals that people have already kind of defined for you, and then like go ahead and start tearing it apart, moving things around. But if you want to like have like a clean poster that's conveying a message, just make it like really simple to start. Actually, making something simple is much harder than than like designing something that has a lot of things on it, because you can make something busy pretty easily, but making sure you're conveying a message super quickly to people with very little on the page is weirdly much harder. But a good thing to remember is like the idea of a poster is you might see it like passing the street, might see it quickly in an ad, like a billboard, you're driving by it, those type of things. They're passed by and you want to grab someone's attention really quickly. So keeping it as simple as possible will do that for you. And again, like you see on the left side, again, color, contrast. Something that I do want to emphasize too is making sure things are accessible to people. Make your fonts large enough and bold enough that people will not have trouble reading it. I don't love the top left one. I don't think that's as accessible because you're putting white on like a yellow. That tends to be really, really difficult to read. If you want something to be super legible, black on white, right? White on black. And then make sure you have enough space around the letters. Make sure you're using a really clean font like this. And yeah, that'll make it so it's just easier for people to read. I won't go into accessibility details because I feel like that's pretty deep in there. You can actually test those things out. There are certain standards that you can meet. But as long as you're making things like generally large enough, if you a good like just simple test you can do is squinting. And if you can't read it, it's probably not going to be easy for other people to read. So whatever your key messages are, so probably your tagline and your title, you want to make large enough so that people could read it if you're like squinting. Or if you don't have great eyesight, you could just take your glasses off and see if you could read it. So finalizing the design.
Oh, we just got another question, Sam.
Oh, yeah, let's go for it.
Just on tooling. What are your thoughts on using AI to create the movie poster?
Controversial. No, we're getting into the AI discussion. there's a lot of...
Are you using Runway ML at the moment or are you using anything? Like?
Am I personally using anything? I use AI more as... I'm actually helping someone design a card game with AI imagery. I'm taking it as inspiration. It gives me a really good base, but I'm also using lots of like people figures, so they always kind of mess up faces and things like that. I have to go in and tweak it anyways, but I don't like to use it as like a one for one. I don't know where the data set's coming from. That's an issue. There's a lot of ethics around AI, and I don't mean just like stealing other people's art. I mean like you don't know what they're putting in. I'm not going to get too deep into the AI thing, but I would recommend using it more for inspiration than it would be for actual final creation of your product. Also, as far as I can tell, I've not seen good AI when it comes to typography. It puts in fake words, it breaks the letters, so I don't think you're actually going to get an output that you love. If you want to go so far as to put in a bunch of your images and try to train a model, I think maybe that's a little more time consuming than than it needs to be. I'd say just work your own creativity. But if you want some inspiration, you could use it, I suppose. I just haven't seen it work well with anything related to like faces and type. So
I've got another question for you.
Yeah.
I'm going to take you away from my AI. It's all right. You answered it. It's all good. I love your stuff. Using it for inspiration. So my other question is, you know, the American Beauty poster, right? It focuses on the stomach, right? It's very provocative. On your A Couple Back, like how do you choose what the focus is of that image? Because obviously there's actors, and in our world, that's avatars. Obviously there's props. Obviously there's scenery, right? Mm-hmm. So how do you choose what goes on and what is the best, item or 3D object or whatever that's going to reel people in?
Yeah, I think that just goes back to the beginning, the fundamentals, is making sure that what you're throwing on there is giving them a snippet of your story. So if it's really about a singular object, definitely have that object in there, right? either the particular character or characters interacting with that object. Like the Titanic, it's kind of about the boat. Like, it's about the boat, but the story itself is about these two characters. So they're like, well, we can't make a movie poster without the boat on it, right? That's a little confusing. People know it for that. So they have the boat, but then they have very large zoomed in, kind of like this faded image of this, of these two particular people, because that's really what it's about. The Moonlight one's actually quite interesting. If you look at it closer, it's the same image, but in different, it kind of seems like in different timelines or like different instances. So I think that could also be an interesting way of kind of like showing the same character, but telling the story a little bit in like a snippet. Little Bit Sunshine too. Like, you're seeing this moment, it's very active. They chose this because the whole thing is kind of like, it's a family affair. It's a race trying to get there. Like, you can tell that there's some sort of challenge that they have to overcome. It's a little silly just seeing how he's running. So they're trying to show the characters a little bit, shows there is action to this, that there's something moving forward. Barbie, this poster is just, it's Barbie. That's not a great example, frankly.
It's a good example of like using font and placement, you know, in a really interesting way, right?
Yeah. They're all about brand. That's what the whole idea behind the Barbie movie was, to sell a brand, right? It was to rebrand themselves. It was to remind people, like, hey, we're Barbie. Look, we're cool. Love us, please. So they did a great job with that. They didn't really need to emphasize, they didn't need to tell much of a story. They just needed to show their actors and show their brand. And if you look through it, they have so many posters. Usually that's what you see. You see particular people that they showed, that they like brought into this movie, so particular actors. I mean, they have like Dua Lipa in there. They have a poster with just her on it. Like, it's like, look at us versus we're trying to tell like a great story. It's entertaining, but you know, they had different motivations, as opposed to like Jaws or Back to the Future. Like, look at Back to the Future, it's overlaid with so many images. Like, that's not a particular scene, but it is showing you like different instances and like this moment, like this like moment of realization from like the main actor, or this moment of like terror and fear. It's trying to evoke emotion in the viewer. This isn't really evoking so much emotion, but it's a very different type of film. So if it's like funny, you could probably go maybe a little bit, it's a little like more subtle in Little Miss Sunshine, but I do think that it's pretty well done.
I think what the other thing I noticed about these examples is that they're stripped back. They're really simple. Like, that's another question. Like, how do you know when a poster is done or got too much busyness happening on it? You've talked about legibility in font, but like layering on things. How do you know when it's done?
I mean, that's a hard question for design in general, because my answer is it's never done. I'm pretty sure I might have written at the end. It basically, things are done when the timeline is over, or just feels right or good enough. Yeah, the done phase is a really, really hard one for design. What I wrote in here is, I think it kind of leads back to that slide that we left off on, which is like final, like how do you actually get to that final product? You want to make sure you get a lot of feedback and take in the feedback, you know, with a grain of salt, because you can also take that feedback and you don't have to take it to heart. It's a lot of it's subjective, honestly. So as long as like you feel like you've nailed whatever your goal is, then it can be done for you, right? The way that I look at design is it's constantly iterative. Like, there's no perfect final version of it. You just have to stop at some point. That's kind of like a designer mindset. But if you feel like it will do what you need it to do, like I was saying, like hit that goal, then you can call it a day as well. You don't have to be a perfectionist about it. That is generally what designers tend to do, is become perfectionists about it. You don't have to be like me. That's totally reasonable. but the way that you generally know it's in a good place is getting enough positive feedback about it. Yeah, sometimes you can make something that people don't really love, like the people that you're getting feedback from don't necessarily love, but it could be a big hit. Some people might grow on them over time. I've had posters that I absolutely love. Everything Everywhere All at Once is one of them. And that's from one of my favorite artists. Like he did the poster design for that. And I just hated it when I saw it and it grew on me. I might have been a little bit because I knew his art as something different, but I just wasn't super into it. But then after I saw the movie, I appreciated it more. It was quite an interesting poster. I don't think I threw it in here. It's unfortunate. I can look it up and show you all, but the feedback that will probably give you the most telling result as to whether you've like really met your goal would be to show it to people who you really want to watch it. Like who's your target audience? That's pretty fundamental in a lot of things. Sometimes it's hard to know exactly who your target audience is when it comes to things that are like maybe a little more on the artistic side, which really can be film. Like it can be pretty, you can go really out there with film. It's a little bit different than if you're doing like a documentary type of thing, where you'll kind of understand at least someone's interest. But yeah, feedback and when you're tired of looking at it too. Yeah. So other ways you can finalize this would be making sure that you have reviewed it, don't have typos, show it to like a lot of people. Even huge companies have gone out with typos or issues where things are cut weird or the color is off, stuff like that. Don't be the only one to look at it. That is like my number one piece of feedback is get as much feedback as possible. And then like the last part of finalizing is just making sure that it is presentable in the formats you need it to be. If you're going to print it, there's so much to go through with printing. Make sure you talk to whoever the printer is to make sure it's in the right format, the right size. There's bleed lines. It's a whole thing. If you're doing digital, that's much, much easier, but you might still need different like crops of things. For different formats, even for social, you know, like you could do square and it's pretty safe for a lot of places, but you might want like a larger size or you might want to post it to a story and that changes significantly. So at that point, you have to just like make a lot of different versions and tweak things a little bit. Even if it's resizing things down and making sure whatever color background you're putting it on, it makes sense. That's going to be probably the least fun, most tedious step of this, but that is like the final wrap up. Yep. Do you have another question?
Nope, I thought that was the last slide. Sorry, my bad.
Oh, this is
Accidental unmute. Continue.
it's pretty, it's we're almost done there. So recap of the key takeaways, basically make sure it's telling your story. It's imparting the information you need to impart. It's evoking some sort of emotion. And if your intent is to drive sales, that it's doing that. If you don't see like it's hitting these points, change it, try another version. When you actually look up movie posters, they have so many versions. Barbie's got like 800. It's an insane amount of movie posters. You don't need to go that crazy. But when you're doing those iterations, if you aren't sure which one's the right one, try a couple. You don't have to have the same thing. It's like an ad. They don't generally put out one ad. They'll put out like five different versions. They're trying to target different people. You'll see which one performs the best. And yeah, it'll probably bring in different audiences. Always be iterating. So taking that feedback when you have it out there, you can iterate on it. If it's a print one, it's going to be a lot harder, but if it's a digital one, it's pretty easy to swap out. Yeah, and have fun with it, obviously, because it's a fun activity. Designing is fun, even though it can get a little, if it gets a little daunting or overwhelming at any point, take a break with any sort of creative thing. Step away from it. Do something different, take your mind off of it. If you stare at it for too long, you'll probably start to hate it. You'll get frustrated with it. So, like any activity, just walk away, don't think about it, and then come back to it. That's it.
Love it. Thank you so much. So much wisdom shared in bite-sized chunks. Really appreciate it. I've got some questions and we'll also go to community questions as well. So if you've got any questions, please drop them in any of our chats, YouTube Live, any of our socials. Our team will sweep them up and we will get them. So I've got a question on type. So if you look at the Everything Everywhere All at Once, they've got one poster that's photography and one poster that's cartoon. Obviously, it would be logical for Armona Shorts to show in world. But what is the choice there? Why have they made that choice? That's one that's cartoon and one that's real, like real photography.
I think, I mean, I can only speculate why they made those choices. I think that the movie itself, luckily I have seen this one, the movie itself is a piece of art. So I think that they really wanted to show and capture that in a way that they couldn't in a single image. So they were like, we want to make something that feels, it's kind of trippy, honestly. Like, it's something you kind of, you have to watch more than once. And if you look at that imagery, it's very like, it's very much like a kaleidoscope. Trippy is the only word I can think of at this point. It's super trippy. And I think it evokes a similar emotion to watching that. It's a little bit overwhelming, which isn't something I would necessarily say is great for a movie poster, but it works really well for that particular film because it has a very specific style to how it's filmed, how it's edited. So that's probably why they made that additional illustrative poster. They also picked an artist that's like, I don't know. I think that he's pretty well known. I don't think he's like, everybody knows him. He's not Pablo Picasso, but like he is, he's not nobody. So I think that that also brings along somewhat of an audience just through that. It's thoughtful in that way. And then, yeah, you do like still image posters because, and they probably did a lot of versions of this poster, more than two. Because you want to show people like what it actually looks like, how it's filmed, what the tone is. Like when you're editing too, there's so many things you can do while you're filming, and then also post-production, lots of like additional lighting. You're probably also adding in fonts. You might be adding in animations to the actual film. So trying to like show a little bit of what it's actually going to look like is why they show that version as well.
Yeah, I love that. It's a work of art. That's a great film. What are your favorite movie posters of all time? If you don't want to name one, like name three.
Oh gosh. I mean, honestly, I think the one that I thought of immediately while working on this was the Jaws one. It just works so well. I don't even think I've seen Jaws, frankly, but I know what it is. It's like iconic. Like, it's, I don't like watching scary things, and like a shark, I don't really want to. But I know what it's about. It's really clear what it's about on the poster. So I think they did a fantastic job. I actually really like the Back to the Future one too. The more I've looked at it, I think that they don't necessarily hit the mark on making the tagline as simple as possible. That's a lot of words. So I would have, you know, pared that down. But you get a vibe from like how they styled the font that they use. Like, this is not a font. This is like a hand-drawn, handmade logo for this movie. As opposed to like Jaws, which there's a little something here that might be specific, like with the J and the S. But this also could have been like a typeface that they pulled. I really like Little Miss Sunshine too, but that's also probably because I just really like the movie.
Yeah, it's a great way of like showing the axes on the top and the movement, like you say.
That was unique also. And they managed to fit a quote in here that was really short, and it's giving them some like legitimacy too. So like USA Today, winning, hilarious, and heartwarming.
Yeah, I love it. If you can fit a quote in, that'd be pretty good as well. Yeah. Such good advice. Okay, so I've got one more question, which is just around taking note of the type of the film. So we've got five categories, right? Anime, sci-fi, experimental, new, and so on. When a lot of what you've discussed is like, work out what you want to convey in your movie poster, and is it a good practice to work out the emotions that you want to convey. So Titanic, drama, Barbie, fun and light. Just start there with like the emotions you want to convey, and then make sure that when you, as you're going through and creating your work, that they're, you know, how do you think about emotion? Like, apart from the film, that's just a very open question.
Yeah, I mean, like any design thing is going to evoke some sort of emotion, whether it's positive or negative, or what you meant for it to convey or meant for it to provoke or not. I think it goes really tightly with, I don't know where it is on here, with your narrative. Like, I think whatever the story is you're going to tell, whatever that emotion is that you're trying to evoke overall, like, that's your core concept. I try not to use the word concept in this in particular, but that is like the way that at Parsons I was taught to look at design. Like, what is that core thing, that pillar that you're constantly referencing? A lot of the time for my particular work, it's a user, and then I look at what their goals are and their motivations are. So it's kind of like you as the user in this case for an artist. What story are you trying to tell? How do you want people to feel at the end of the movie? Try to get that into the poster. And while you're getting feedback, if you want to ask very specific questions, ask them generally, how does this poster make you feel, to see if you are actually conveying the emotion that you're trying to provoke in them. And ask them, what do you think is happening in this poster? What do you think this movie is about? You might not want them to know exactly everything everywhere at all once. You do not know what is happening. You're like, that is a lot. But it worked really well, because it was like, what is that? That's something I haven't seen. So if you're doing something that's like experimental, that could be fantastic for it, right? Just making them feel anything is better than making them feel nothing. So as long as there's some sort of emotion that isn't like, that makes me unhappy or like super uncomfortable, interested is good. But yeah, just try to make them feel literally anything at that point. Yeah.
Okay. I've got another community question for you. How, in terms of the hierarchy of messages, maybe go back a few slides mm-hmm. to those examples, how important is using like the call to action or wording coming soon versus all the other hierarchy, you know, of comms that you might be trying to communicate? So you've obviously got the actors or avatars' names, you've got the title of the movie, you've got, you know, either log line or summary of what the movie is, and then you've got coming soon. So like, in your mind, what's the hierarchy there of one of these? You know, maybe it's Little Miss Sunshine or whatever, because they've got quite a lot of copy on there.
Yeah, you can see this in here, only in theaters July 21st, or on DVD December 19th. I don't think it's at the top. I don't think that the hierarchy of when it's happening is at the top. It is something that, like, if you have a specific, well, you're probably going to have some sort of specific date or coming soon, or like, you should give them a general idea of when to expect it. It's not like, you want them to understand and be interested first, and then they will look to figure out when it is too. Like, look at Moonlight. This is coming soon is tiny. It's so small. Because it's more important that there's interest in it. Like, well, when you want them to look at this, be like, oh, that looks cool. How do I see that? When they get to the, like, how do I get to, like, how do I get to watch this? When do I get to watch this? Getting to that is difficult enough. So I would de-emphasize that. Like, here, they don't have, this has, like, barely any text on it. This is to, like, give themselves credit. And show that there are people that, like, it's like, oh, I love Ryan Gosling and Margot Robbie. Like, I definitely want to see that. Oh, I know Barbie. Oh, that sounds funny. Oh, okay, I can see it on July 21st. I will wait for that, right? It's at the very bottom. It is the lowest. Because people read top, left, right, down. At least here in America, they do. A lot of people do, left or right. So that hierarchy, it's probably closer to the bottom. If you have the credits, put them near the top. That's also why they did it like this. These are our actors. This is our like credit. This is what we want you to feel. This is what we're called. This is how you get it. And then they have like the additional necessary credits after that.
So the only thing I've got to add there is when I've reviewed out of home creative for Netflix, that we use this, I guess, term, which is like mum, mate, bus. So it's got to be super simple that your mum would get it. Mates, as in your mates, you know, it's on point, right? If you're telling your mates about this thing, it's got to be on point, right? And then it's got to like instantly be conveyed on a bus, because that's how quickly, if you think about placement of where these posters are, and back in the day where people did go out and about and see out of home posters on billboards and bus stops and stuff. I don't even know if you call them that in the US. But yeah, like it has to be conveyed in very quickly. So mum, mates, bus is another like method of like just checking like you haven't gone over the top with lots of elements. Sam, you've been incredible. You've shared so much. Thank you so much. I'm just going to recap some of the learnings that you shared. Typography is really important, but don't go to DaFont. Go to Adobe or Google Fonts. This is really good. This is good in life, let alone life for a movie poster challenge. Legibility is really important. It is. We look at a lot of stuff on mobile now. So just making sure things are, the most important things are legible. So you've talked about hierarchy of messaging there. So, you know, in terms of sizing of fonts and what you're putting in there. And I think, yeah, getting it reviewed by and getting feedback from people that are actually going to watch it. So for us, for Mona Shorts, it's people that are in World and Explorers, you know, that are reviewing your work. You know, probably you're going to get a biased opinion from your partner or friends, right? But I would go external and try and get someone that's never, doesn't know what this is about, and seeing if they understand what the poster is and what the film could be about. And then placement, so choosing what goes on in terms of contrast, in terms of typography, but also, you know, this content elements has been super interesting in terms of what they've chosen to focus on: the cut through of the face, the Titanic boat, the letter and hanging out of the letter, and then Little Miss Sunshine creating action. So I think that dynamism on the screen, how much you're creating and starting with the emotions and starting with what you want to invoke and intrigue. So you don't have to communicate everything in this poster. It's about drawing people in so they come and watch it, or, you know, want to come to the premiere, right? So, yeah, I think that's really important. This isn't an exercise in conveying what your entire movie's about in one image. This is an exercise in intrigue. So, yeah, thank you so, so much. We have enjoyed having you back. I forgot to mention that Sam worked for us for a hot minute as well at the beginning in my intro. But yeah, we've loved having you back as a friend of Mona, and thank you for sharing your wisdom. We've really appreciated it. So yeah, thanks all. And thank you for your time. Yeah, we hope you come back and come into our experience. So we're having a 5-day premiere event from September the 26th in World in Hollywood 2050. There's a teaser that just gone out that we'll share the link for as well as a follow-up. The movie poster challenge is live. You have until Sunday at midnight to submit your movie poster. So for your Pomona Shorts, with prizes up to $300. So please get your entries in if you feel like flexing your creative skills. And because of this amazing workshop, you should be able to do that now. But thank you everyone for your time. Thank you to the team, to Ty, to everyone that's produced this show. We really appreciate all the hands in the background supporting this. So thanks to everyone, Ty, Christian, Yunji and Sierra, that have supported this. So yeah, we'll see you on the socials. If you have any questions and you're listening to this on catch up, feel free to jump in our Discord and head into Mona Shorts Fest and ask your question there. We will do our best if Sam's not available. All right. Thanks so much, Sam. Really appreciate your time. Legend.
Thanks. Thank you.